Hello everybody and welcome to today's digital adventure. My name's Dave Meschler and I am the founding artistic director and conductor for Awesome Orchestra Collective. I'm really excited to have you join us today, where we'll be rehearsing and playing through one of the most exciting symphonic finales in the entire repertoire, the last movement in Brahms Symphony No. 4. Now, today, before we get started, make sure that you've got your sheet music downloaded, ideally printed out, but you can also read off it another device than what you're watching this video on. We're going to tune up in just a second, and then we're going to run through the entire piece from the top at tempo. So feel free to make mistakes and just get to know the piece if you haven't played it already. Then you're going to take a break after each segment and we'll rehearse through various pieces. I'll give you some notes, you'll have a moment to rest, and you'll also be hearing from various ambassadors of different sections, demonstrating and talking through their favorite sections of the piece. So there'll be breaks in between, time to regroup. The whole thing lasts about an hour. A couple other important notes. Each time we start, you'll be playing along with a recording that's in the Creative Commons license by the Czech National Philharmonic, so thank you to them for this very good performance. You'll get a small placard before we start each segment that has which segment we're rehearsing and if it's under tempo or not. And then you'll see a pickup note, pickup beat from myself for each one, visually but not audibly. The whole piece is in 3-4, but for some sections, it's in 3-2, so I'll be in a subdivided slow 3 or 6. All right, I think that's about it. Let's get tuned up and try a first run through at this piece. Thanks so much and have fun today.
brief discussion about Johannes Brahms and his Symphony No. 4, in particular the last movement. So Brahms is one of our most famous beards in classical music, and to honor that, I have attempted to bring some good beard energy into this. So Brahms is also one of their three Bs, right? We get Bach, then Beethoven, then Brahms. But does Brahms really deserve it, or did he just happen to be the next person who got kind of famous with a B name? So Brahms is born in Germany in 1833, and he died in 1897. You also might remember him from the National Endowment for the Arts television campaign, where Raisin Brahms were featured, and Brahms would come storming into children's houses and force them to hear piano music. My personal favorite fact about Brahms is that he, every single day, went to Der Roten Igel, which is the Red Hedgehog, to eat and have, like, a beer with his friends. It was the local pub. Also, good fact about Brahms, maybe in a threesome with Clara Schumann and Robert Schumann? We don't really know. Maybe. Seems like it might have happened. I'm gonna ditch this for the rest of the time. So, Brahms has this really interesting position in music, much like Beethoven, of sort of bridging old and new. He really, like, embraced the form of classical era, which explains why he's still writing symphonies while other people are starting to do other things. But he gets a little dirty and dissonant with the harmonies, so he's kind of mixing two things together here. Brahms would have really liked that I just compared him to Beethoven, because musicologists basically think that he ripped his whole first symphony off of Beethoven 5, and Wagner, whose opinion we don't care about because he was a racist, but he had a good zinger here, which is that he called it Beethoven's 10th, which is rude and funny. So the 4th symphony is Brahms' last symphony, and also it was his last public appearance, was at a performance, but you'll notice that that premiered in 1885, which is still, like, over 10 years from Brahms's death. He kind of took a break after he wrote this. He got a really cute young girlfriend, and he kind of retired from composing, and he ended up doing a lot more sort of passion projects. So this last movement, very specifically, is a dance form called the passacaglia, which is where a motif in the bass gets passed around and has variations all over it. So in this piece, you'll hear everybody play the theme right at the beginning. And Bach actually contributed this motif. It's from a Bach cantata, Nach dir her verlanget mich. And he throws it all over the orchestra. It's basically like musical Where's Waldo. So keep an ear out for that theme. And if you think of that motif as a character, you're gonna hear it go through this huge, very tragic story. And Brahms doesn't give us a happy ending at the end. So enjoy the tragic ride.
Thank you, Molly, for that wonderful insight, as always, into this music. And thank you to everybody for making our way through this awesome piece for the first time. A lot of amazing moments, a lot of tricky moments. So what I'd like to do now is for us to start working our way backwards through the piece. So, in just a minute, we're going to start from the più allegro. This is the coda, so to speak, measure 253, and play to the end, but at about 3/4 speed. Make sure in this section, winds and brass, to have nice, full, sustained chords anytime you have a dotted half note. Strings, make sure the tremolos on a dotted half note are in the nice lower to middle part of the bow, not at the tip. Also, violas, when we get to measure 280, bring out those triplets. You're the only one with that section. A little bit before that, at rehearsal M, strings, there's some very, very, very wide leaps, especially in the violin. So make sure you really hear the pitch before you move to it. And make those notes not too short. They're not full quarter notes, but otherwise they'll feel a little too strident and we might start to rush or have intonation issues. Otherwise, at the end, just play out nice full sounds. Brahms always wants a full sound. It's not necessarily about being loud. And you, as you probably noticed in the recording, the last chord, the penultimate bar, will hold for just a couple extra beats, a little mini fermata. All right, let's try it again. Okay, now that we've practiced the ending under tempo, let's go back a little further to measure 193, and we'll practice this section as well as the transition into the più allegro at tempo. A couple things to note before we rehearse that. 193 is one of the few sections in the piece where everyone is playing fortissimo. Make sure, as always with Brahms, that it's not just loud, but it's a nice full sound, whether you're playing short accented notes on two, or if the strings, your line later that you come in with tremolo, is a nice full legato line, and the tremolo is, the bow is more towards the middle or bottom near the frog rather than at the end of the bow. A couple other things. At rehearsal I, make sure to focus on the swells so we get a nice depth of nuance in that phrasing, whether it's two bars or four bar phrases. And lastly, eight before rehearsal L, make sure that the pizzicatos in the strings are played the same dynamic as they would be if they were played arco. In other words, don't let them be too soft just because they're pizzicato. Okay, let's give it a whirl.
Thank you. Well, I am Sheila. I'm the ambassador for the keyboard and harp section. I am not going to offer you any great tips or tricks on how to play your parts in this session today, because Brahms didn't include any piano or harp in this piece, or unfortunately in any of his big orchestral works. But I wanted to invite the keyboardists and harpists to our session anyway. One of my favorite things about being a part of the Awesome Orchestra is that we are a community of musicians who are excited to support each other, both while we're playing together and while we're cheering each other on, whether we're doing so during a long rest in the middle of piece, or when we're sitting out part of a piece or a whole piece, or when it's a pandemic and we're all physically far apart. So if you are a pianist or a harpist or any other instrumentalist who Brahms neglected to write for, I hope you'll grab a drink or a snack and enjoy the session anyway. And I can't wait to make music with you again soon.
Okay, now that we have the ending more or less figured out, let's go back to measure 129, where we have the restatement of the theme from the winds and brass after the slow section. Now, the main thing to be careful about here is four or eight bars before letter F strings really bring out these hairpins, and continue to do that throughout in rehearsal F. Then at G, strings, these scales just happen really quickly. And it's not so much that the scales are hard, they're just simple melodic minor scales in concert E minor. But make sure that when we move back to 3-4, or rather when it's you're just playing quarter notes, that we don't rush the space in between. It's a lot of notes and then what feels like a lot of space. Otherwise, let's give it a whirl. And when we get to rehearsal I, we'll stop.
Oh, hello, horns. It's Joe and Betts. How's it going? So, let's talk about some beautiful articulation. And of course, I'm talking about the gorgeous brass chorale at letter E. One of the most distinct articulations in this section is the slur with the staccato, or otherwise known as the portato. We horn players tend to call that just lazily a D tongue or a da tongue, but it's very important to the sense and the feel and the structure of this section because it really gives that sense of yearning that we have before we reach the recapitulation after the fermata in about 8 or so bars. So let's demonstrate. So you'll notice the second half of that phrase is fully slurred to provide a great contrast to what preceded it. It's really that just barely imperceptible separation between each of those elongated notes that gives the brass chorale that sense of depth that is so often heard in many Brahms symphonies. Anyway, that's some interesting tidbits about that gorgeous, gorgeous brass chorale, and now back to the rest. Thanks.
Okay, now let's go back to some of my favorite moments in the whole piece, the slow section at starting at 97, where we receive several variations that are now the same number of measures, but twice as long effectively. This is a beautiful section where starting with a flute solo, accompanied by strings and later low brass and horns. And we never want to lose sense of the pulse in this section and the phrasing, whether it be crescendos or line or harmonic resolution. That's so important. Otherwise, it just feels like we're just kind of slogging through the motions here. So keep those phrases, find the long phrases, and bring out the Debussy and the cello and violas in this section. And when the low brass come in, really, really lead us here. It's the main theme in this beautiful major version. And right before we transition back to the fast 3-4, I'll give a cutoff and a 1-2-3. And then we'll play through a little bit of that section that we just rehearsed. All right, let's give it a shot.
Thank you.
My name's Ellie Ganellan. I'm an ambassador for the flute section of the Awesome Orchestra. I'm going to talk about the solo in the finale to Brahms' Fourth Symphony. It's a good one to have under your belt since it's requested often at orchestra auditions. It's a beautiful, aching melody, and you'll see why it's so famous in a minute. When you're playing along at home, it can be easy to drag the tempo. Be sure to keep the line moving, but look for the notes that have a hairpin under them, as those notes you can take a little more time, and they really help to define the phrase. I'm going to start playing from a few bars leading into the solo. You'll notice the actual solo should be a little bit louder than the intro preceding it. As you can hear, the melody grows with intensity. Listen for the underlying bass line as it will help you as you build your phrase. Here's what that sounds like. All right, that's all for me. Happy playing, everyone.
Okay. Now, let's go back and all the way to measure 65. And this is in the middle of letter C. And this is some of the more gnarly passages for strings, some of Brahms' most intense contrapuntal writing, which is, you know, one of the signatures of Brahms. His counterpoint is always perfect, if not unforgiving. So, we're going to start here and go all the way up to rehearsal E. Mostly strings, just be very specific when we transition from sextuplets into 16th notes and keep those even. Etc., etc. And low strings, starting at this section, bring out this, you know, five beat phrase, where you have 1, 2, 3, 1, shunk. That's sort of the main phrasing and melodic material underneath everything else. And then we'll practice the transition into the 6-4 for up to letter E. All right, here we go. Thank you.
Hi friends, this is Amanda, one of the violin ambassadors, and I'm going to play a couple excerpts for you today. The first one is the section that starts at measure 65, and the tricky part about this section is that there are a lot of string crossings. So what I would recommend is to place your bow sort of halfway between each string so you can cross strings more efficiently, and that's what this looks like. So the next section I'm going to cover is at rehearsal G, and this is a section just full of notes and full of scales. So I have three recommendations for this section. The first one is to mark down where each big beat and half beat falls, and these can serve as anchor points for you. The second recommendation is to use one bow per quarter note, so you don't have to make one bow last an entire measure. And then last recommendation is to not worry too much or not stress out about the notes that fall in the middle. Focus on the first note and the last note, making sure that they're both correct in pitch and correct in time. This is what that looks like. So the next section I'm going to cover is at rehearsal H, and the focus I want to have here is to make sure that each of these stress points, so the sforzando and the accent notes, land on a down bow, and this means that we have to start the first two arpeggios with an up bow, and then the third arpeggio just starts with a down bow, and that's what this looks like.
Okay, let's practice that section again, but start a little sooner. Let's go back to rehearsal B. Now this is pretty early on in the variations, so things are still pretty straightforward, but there's a lot of interplay between sections, and of course dynamics as always. So continue to bring those out, even more so when you're playing along at home. And when we get to letter C, make sure we have a nice response from the winds, brass, and low strings to the first and second violins who have this study. Make sure you respond to them one beat later with a nice full dotted 16th rhythm. And this time we'll stop at the 3-2 at 97. All right, let's give it a shot. Thank you. Okay, let's go back to the top and rehearse this first theme for all the variations. Now that we know the variations, the theme itself is strangely very satisfying to play. And Wind and Brass, please note that the first chord at measure one is just forte, not to be confused with the later iterations at the coda, which are very similar, but fortissimo. He reserves that for the end. So give a nice full sound for these first eight bars. And any time in the seventh bar that anyone has a concert F natural, usually it's the low instruments, please bring that out. It's just a way of Brahms being Brahms. otherwise, strings, when you first enter, make sure those pizzicatos are forte. Nice full sound, and we hear evenly divided between all three notes. And then we'll go on and play up to rehearsal D. So let's take it back at measure one. All right, everybody, go ahead and just shake it out if you haven't yet. We're going to run the whole thing through from beginning to end. Just remember all those little details we went over, the phrasings, the syncopation, the accents, now that we know this piece a lot better. And I really look forward to being able to play this in person with y'all soon. And before we finish, I want to say a couple special thank yous to our ambassadors, especially those who made videos to help us out. Thank you. to our bassoon ambassador, Kat Walsh, for her legal consultation again with Creative Commons license in public domain. To our bass ambassador, Travis Kindred, for his help in streaming all this to each of you. To Brendan West for his help in recording and editing. To our staff, especially Brian Anna McCune and Bailey Hopkins, for their help in editing as well. And to all of you for joining us, to anyone who's ever donated to us. This is an uncertain time, and we love being able to still connect with you musically, despite it having to be virtually. Remember, afterwards, we're going to have not just a Q&A with our resident musicologist, but also a social hangout. So stick around. But for now, let's give it a whirl. Have fun.
Thank you.
Congrats. We did it. I hope you had as much fun playing along at home as we did making this for you. Please stay after and see our Q&A with myself and Molly Phelan, our resident musicologist who you already heard from a little bit. We're going to talk about this piece and awesome orchestra and Brahms, and also there's going to be a time for social hang afterwards with any of y'all audience or players who want to chat on Zoom. Stay tuned. We will post that link in the chat rooms. Thank you again to everybody who made this happen, especially those who have donated or become monthly donors on our website. If you want to find out how to support us during this really difficult time for artists, please go to our website, awesomeorchestra.org/donate. We really appreciate it. Otherwise, thank you. And you can relax, crack open a drink, and we'll see you in the post-session hang. Thank you. All right. Welcome, everybody. My name is Dave Meschler. I'm the founding artistic director for Awesome Orchestra. And I want to say thank you for joining us for our digital adventure today, those playing, those watching. And we hope you've had fun rehearsing through the last movement of Brahms 4. And I want to say thank you to our resident awesome musicologist, Molly Phelan, for joining us again.
Thank you.
Should we clink beers?
Cheers. Cheers.
Cheers.
We did it.
Great. We're off to a great start. This has been really fun to do another video with you and on Brahms. Obviously, people got to see you in the video with your awesome beard.
Yeah.
Before we start, we did a special thank you, but I want to say a shout out to one of our flute ambassadors, Ellie Ganalen, whose birthday it is today. Happy birthday, Ellie. Yeah. You saw her doing the flute solo in the middle of the video. Also, after this is over, please join us on a after digital social hang, where we'll be on a Zoom link that was posted in all the chats and also in the email that was sent out about this event. So when we're done with that, we'll start that up in a few minutes. But for now, let's talk about Brahms and this piece and any other questions that people have. So, Molly, this we got the 3-minute version compressed of Brahms, but after being involved or after watching through this, or you know, getting more into the Fourth Symphony, what are your thoughts about Brahms still for this piece?
Yeah, so I actually I come from choral world, so symphony stuff was a little out of my wheelhouse for Brahms. And I feel like perhaps there is a little bit of some disparaging of Brahms online. I think he's gotten wrapped up in the cancel Beethoven thing that's going on. And I think it has a little to do with the fact that when Brahms is good, Brahms is exceptionally good, altering what music is good. But when Brahms is not good, he's just fine. And there's a lot of he wrote a lot of music, so there's a lot of sort of fine Brahms. But I think the Fourth Symphony is one of those pieces that actually is Brahms kind of rising to some of his higher heights. I think he's trying, he's doing what Brahms does best, which is incorporate incorporate older musical forms, but he really is augmenting them. Whereas, like, if you think of Brahms' First Symphony, which is basically like a Beethoven ripoff, this is like a whole different thing. Like, this feels like totally real Brahms.
Yeah. No, I agree. I mean, Brahms at times, for me, it's always about the first listen through. When I listen to Brahms for the first time, I'm usually like, that was kind of cool. Or like, maybe I dozed a little. But when I listen to him like the third, fourth, fifth, tenth time, I'm like, holy shit, this is perfect. Or like the counterpoint, the orchestration, the sense of form, the subtleness. And it is wild. He was very much the same. He was in that same place of concert music where Beethoven was, like you said. He was totally. Really knew his Bach. He really knew everything that came before him. And he was such a staunch traditionalist too, that he, you know, he never wrote opera. It was just like, no, forget this. I'm not into this. Absolute music. That argument's kind of old now. Absolute versus programmatic. But yeah. Coming back to this piece was kind of fun too, because I had spent a lot of time in graduate school going over this piece and rehearsing with our orchestra. As I mentioned earlier, it was like the piece for our the new conductor that was coming into grad school was all the finalists were practicing and with the orchestra for this piece. So I got to hear it a lot and hear a bunch of different takes. And like every recording is wildly different. So it's just one of those things that I would never listen to a Brahms piece once and then remember much about it, but then it just slowly kind of seeps into your soul. So, what about, you know, one thing people have been asking about too is how hard it is to find music for these kind of particular events. So, I don't know if that's, are there any other questions we should jump into before we do logistical, or that you just want to talk about?
I mean, I did get a question about the other beards of classical music sent to me. So I would like to shout out to Verdi, and I guess sort of Grieg had a very good mustache. But to be fair, Brahms, I think, is the penultimate beard in classical music.
I would totally agree with that.
I say penultimate because I'm waiting for somebody to be the ultimate beard.
Yeah, I love that there's that famous picture of him next to Richard Strauss. And Richard Strauss is like, only has a mustache, and he looks super, young and healthy. But they're like, oh yeah, this is him at this age, and Brahms is actually way younger, but he just looks older because his beard is so epic. So are there any questions from the audience or other chats that we should answer, or... We've got Mind Spillage, Cat Walsh says, as an inner voice person, I appreciate Brahms giving fun parts to the inner voice. Any thoughts there?
I think that probably goes back to like the Bach thing. Like I think of Bach as doing really similar things as somebody who grew up singing the alto part on Bach. Like you're often the least boring part because the outsides are sort of 1 and 5, and what's inside modifies what's happening in the chords. So, like, I feel like the altos and tenors usually, and then, you know, within an orchestra, the inner voices get those, like, really chromatic, nasty, fun parts because they get to be the people, like, altering the mood of, like, what the sopranos and basses set.
Yeah, that's great. I think I remember reading somewhere about his voice leading. I just became obsessed with like how good it was and like really not learning counterpoint until I'd studied Brahms. And for those watching that may not know what counterpoint is, the 5-second description is basically like the way that multiple voices in music move together or apart.
There's a great article about it on canonfodder.net.
All right. So please, that's Molly writes that blog, for those who don't know. So definitely please check out her work there. But yeah, I remember reading somewhere that Brahms like woke up every morning for like 20 years of his life and like wrote a cantus firmus and like had like a fixed bass line that then he like, you know, improvised off, or, you know, did counterpoint exercises every day, which sounds boring, but then he stumbles upon that one every, you know, once a year or a couple times a year where he's like, this is perfect. I can use it for anything. We got a couple other questions I want to get to. One person, we'll do the second one first. Allison Bliss. Allison, welcome. What was Brahms responding to in this world at the time to write such passionately sad music? Great question, Allison. Thank you.
Great question.
Molly. All right.
So let's see.
This was 1888?
Yeah. Premiered 1885.
85, yeah.
So this is Brahms's last symphony, and it actually, I think, for Brahms was like a big statement to the universe, because kind of after this, he kind of peeled back and was like, I'm just going to take a break. I'm going to work on pieces I want to work on. So this is when Brahms writes the Requiem for Clara Schumann after she died, and a little bit his mom. He gets, like I said in the video, he gets this new girlfriend. So like, this was kind of, I think, like his goodbye to composing in a lot of ways. But as to like what's happening in 1885,
because he wrote it pretty much over the course of like a year, so that it wasn't like, yeah, one of those symphonies that he, it wasn't like his first symphony where he took 20 years to write it.
Right. I mean, the Mikado opens. That's the first thing I thought of. I was like, what else happened in 1885? Yeah. I mean, I'm sorry I don't have a better answer for this, but I don't think he like ever specifically said like this symphony. You know, I think that's one of the things that kind of separates Brahms from some other romantic composers, is that they would tend to be more like, this is what the story of my symphony is. And Brahms is just like, this is music. This is music soul.
Absolute music versus programmatic. And there was plenty of programmatic music going on in the late 19th century with opera.
Totally.
You know,
I mean,
going
you just
crazy.
Made the contrast with Strauss. Super.
Yeah. And, you know, Wagnerism was at its height, more or less. And it's, Brahms was a pretty private person. You know, we didn't really find out a lot of the stuff till later, I think.
Yeah, which is a bummer. So, we would know a lot more about the Schumann if Brahms was a little less private person.
But transitioning, so we have another question. From Corey Johnson, hello, from Portland. I'll paraphrase this a little. talking about if the Nazis hadn't been so into Wagner, would we still think of him, Wagner, as especially racist or just typically racist? My first instinct there, yeah, I mean, one of the reasons for me Nazis got super into Wagner's music and used it so much was because Wagner was racist. He was also a prolific writer, and he wrote a lot of racist stuff, not just put it in his opera stories and whatnot, but he actually was just super racist. He was especially racist. And
yeah,
so.
I think too, like having, so I resisted Wagner operas for a long time because I couldn't sing them, so it was easy to stay away from. But then I started going to them, and it's like, it's not like you can paint a brush and be like, every Wagner opera is like explicitly racist. But I will say most of them are pretty explicitly sexist in a way that is more extreme than most other opera. And like, to the point where like, I left Dutchman because I was like, nope, I don't need to know what happens. I'm done. But like, on the other hand, like Valkyrie, I was like, oh, actually, this is like kind of awesome for women. But then like things like Lohengrin are like, white people are swans from heavens who save you. So like, it's like every Wagner is like, but like as a general like pool, it's not great.
Yeah.
Like, could you?
Which is one of the reasons why. Right? Yeah. Which is why, and maybe that's, who knows if that's what, you know, Brahms was avoiding. But we don't have that issue show up in Brahms. So, Yeah, so...
Yeah, Brahms actually very religiously interested, because if you think of, like, what the Requiem is, like, it's making a Protestant Requiem in the language of the people, which was like, ba-ba-bam! Like, everybody's minds exploded, and that was, like, super sacrilegious, but also very well-received.
Yeah, a German Requiem. I've also had... one of my musicology teachers, Chris Reynolds, always posited... I think he'd written a paper about how Brahms... I don't remember all the details, but that a Requiem is basically Brahms' Fifth Symphony.
Yeah.
Which is, I mean, maybe that's just kind of a fun way for us to codify it or something later, but it is such, it's even more massive scale than his symphonic work, but it is, but the chorus is the main vehicle. It's so freaking good. So one day when we can perform together again, we should definitely do that piece.
Yeah.
But yeah, anything else? I think that's all the questions we have now. Anything else about Brahms or about this piece in particular that you just either love or still kind of flummoxed by or
want to see done? It's worth saying again that this is in this Passacaglia form, which is a form that's both really old but like has kind of carried through into modern times. So things like Caroline Shaw won a Pulitzer 10 years ago for her Passacaglia. So like this is still like a very living art form, even though it's super old. It's this old Baroque like entrance music essentially for lords. So like while we're saying like, oh, Brahms is borrowing from the way back when, like he's not the only, you know, we're not saying Brahms is the only person who's borrowing from these Baroque dance forms. Like that's still a thing that's so actively happening in new music. So while Brahms is being a little old fashioned, like he's not a total anomaly in doing that. And I think that's a thing a lot of composers still like. So balancing that like return to the old and the new is like an ongoing struggle between music. I think especially classical music.
Yeah. It seems to come in waves sometimes. But yeah, that's a great point because I mean, every piece we ever heard was once a new piece. I always like to think of, and there's something about knowing, being, it's not that you have to be aware of what came before you, but a lot of the composers that we've seen over the course of history, the ones that end up standing out a lot, are ones who really have mastery over the old forms, and Brahms is a great example there. Also, like his variation themes of Haydn, which wasn't by Haydn, it turns out, but it just shows how much inspiration he drew from other stuff. And personally, from a practical standpoint as a conductor, I love the theme and variations and passacaglias because for awesome orchestra, whether we're rehearsing them digitally or in person, it's if you're doing a reading session, then it's great to be like, cool, well, here's one theme. Okay, well, let's do it again, but let's one slight difference. So it's very fun for us to take as a piece that is just being rehearsed. So another reason why I thought this movement would go well. So yeah. Okay, I think that's all the questions for now. But Molly, where can people find out more about your work in writing and musicology online?
You can find us at cannonfodder.net, and we are moving to classicaladventureleague.com because of things. But that's where we will be in the near future. And otherwise, sometimes I write things for Awesome Orchestra.
Yay. Awesome. Okay. Well, everybody, Molly, thank you again. And we'll see everybody in just a minute. We're going to start the Zoom call, so hang tight. And hope to see many of you all there to hang out more in person socially. And stay tuned, everyone, for our next event, which sign up for our listserv if you haven't. Check out our website. Follow us on social media. Thanks again, Molly. Thank you to the whole team who made this happen. And we'll see you all in the Zoom hang later, very shortly. All right.